How's the post-party blues? All right. Before we get started, we will proceed with the throwing of the things. Please throw the things. Couple quick announcements. Do stop by Reg and get a t-shirt. All t-shirt proceeds are donations. And we don't want to take them back with us.
I got one more card, watch out. Really
hard. As always, we appreciate feedback from all of you, so please let us know about conference, speakers, anything else. Send it to feedback@shmoocon.org. What's up, Ted? Ted has something to say real quick.
And so many of you may not know, but we're here recording each of the sessions, and so we'll have a table out here with DVDs on them, $10 a piece, 6 for 50, 14 for 100. For the first time, we're also going to offer the whole set on SD card, actually flash card, and I have all of day Saturday done, so if you're interested in that, it'll be like 280 maybe, 2-something. Come see me, because I need a blank SD card from you or a flash drive to be able to load up Sunday, so that at the very end we just have to drop the closing on there. But come see me.
Cool. Thanks, Ted. All right, and now we're ready to start the session. It is the threat results are in. You are not the hacker, presented by Mark Kuhr, co-founder of Synax. So with that, we give you Mark.
Hi, guys. Try to get a late morning slot so everybody had a chance to get some coffee and wake up. So today we're going to be talking about threat intel, disinformation campaigns, and how we can defeat, or our adversaries might defeat, our attribution. This scenario, I drafted this talk about 4 months ago, and I couldn't predict the climate we would be in today with the election. But it's funny how the timing just lined up with the Russia and you know, the Trump situation. So about me quickly, I am in this field for about 10 years. I started out getting a PhD in computer science at Auburn University. Why go and get a PhD? I just kept going because the government kept paying for it. So I went to DISA after that, working on command and control systems. And then I went to the NSA to work on computer network exploitation operations. I see many coworkers, former coworkers out in the audience, so it's good to be back in DC. From there, I went to Novetta, where I worked as a network analyst, working on some attribution aspects, but primarily focused on CNE analyst missions. After that, I went to Synax, and we'll plug Synax later on, but we're recruiting hackers that are really good at breaking into a variety of technologies from the hardware level on up into the apps, and you know, excited to tell you more about that later on. So why do this talk? 4 months ago, I didn't predict that we would be in this current situation, but imagine if we had gathered intelligence based upon open source sources, our OSINT, our threat intel feeds, and our social media, and we had blamed China for hacking the election. And then we took sanctions out on China, which hurt our economy and drove up the price of all our goods, and everything you buy in Walmart went up $5. Okay? And now this could also lead to some implications for the South China Sea, which could lead us into World War III. This attribution game we're playing is very dangerous, and we have to make sure that we get it right. And so I want to just raise the issue and talk openly about how our adversaries are driving that analyst decision cycle towards certain conclusions and how they can actually influence what the characteristics are that we take into effect when we make that decision about attribution. So we'll start with a brief history of information warfare. What we do today, attribution, threat intel, how it all works, what are the characteristics of the campaigns that we're actually looking at, what the attacker does. We'll run through an attacker scenario. And this is important to understand that our attackers are, they're evolving. They're studying what we do on the defensive side, and they are trying to work around us. We need to focus in on our vetting of sources, and this is going to be part of the reality check when we exit this. I want everybody to take away that, you know, there are things we can do to make better decisions, but part of this is also just understanding that it's an inexact science, and it will always be that way. You know, when you go to see a doctor, they call it medical practice for a reason. In a lot of ways, we need to think of our field that way too. So I know we have some beginners in the field attending the conference as well, so I just want to make sure we're all talking about the same definition of threat intel. And not to plug Gartner, but they tend to define a lot of stuff, and the industry accepts it. So in this case, you know, the threat is exploiting the vulnerability and generating an incident. I am focusing this talk on not necessarily the malware attribution, but the people attribution. Who actually conducted the attack? We have to remember that there are actors out there. They sit down on a keyboard, and they're taking this action. Who are they? What are their motivations? And what data are they after? So, information warfare. There's a long history of this. It goes back to the times of Genghis Khan. When Genghis Khan was you know, taking his army across Asia and conquering city after city, one of the things that was paramount to his strategy was sending people ahead of his army who would tell stories to the town people and say, hey, this is a really brutal army. They will torture you. They will kill women and children. This is part of the information campaign he launched. And what we're seeing today is this is evolving. This is still common in every conflict that we've ever seen. But it's evolving into the cyber domain. And we're seeing that adversaries are leveraging the speed at which information travels to really force people to think a certain way that can benefit their strategic outcomes and desires. Ideally, these are unrecognizable. We don't know about the success of many of these campaigns because they're classified, but they're unrecognizable to the outside observer, undetectable. And the false flag operations that we're seeing can dictate the outcomes of political decision makers. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. And lastly, covert influence. So when we look at an actor like our friends, the Russians, they tend to covertly influence political parties and try to get the outcomes that they want. So when they launch a campaign in this environment, you know, we've seen this in 2007 in Estonia, they want to support pro-Russian political groups. They'll launch denial of service attacks against political organizations that do not support their desired outcome. So in Estonia in 2007, they launched denial of service, they did misinformation about the major political parties and started to bolster political minorities. And that minority party ended up not winning the election, but it was a taste of what the Russians are doing now. And we've seen this, if you go back and read the doctrine from the Russians back, you know, many years, all these guys came up in the Soviet Union era who are now running the Russian military, and this is a very cost-effective solution for them. They're able to, you know, influence and cause strategic benefits for the nation without expending a lot of military costs. So if you look at the United States strategy, we build fantastic war fighters. We put tanks on the ground. We deploy troops all over the world. The Russians are taking a different strategy. It's much cheaper. All they do is they have a covert action team. They have special forces on the ground and some misinformation to the political parties to guide their outcomes. And we saw this in Ukraine in 2014 when they framed the downing of the MH17 on pro-Ukrainian rebels. Okay, so they started to tell a story of how the shoot down of that plane was actually an assassination attempt on Vladimir Putin. That is not true from what everybody's saying today. But in reality, you know, people started to believe it. They did polls after that. And everybody was believing that it was this separatist group that had taken control of a Russian missile launcher and tried to assassinate Vladimir Putin. So that cyber covert influence was bolstered, that influence was bolstered through media stories, state-run television, marketing ads, emails, all of that combined to push the population to believe a certain thing. And we're even seeing it today. This article that I have up on the screen is from January 8th. The Turkish industry minister says that the U.S. hacked his networks. So if you look at the source, it's Moscow, it's the Russian news agency. This is not true. I'm not going to talk about U.S. operations, but it's very unlikely that we would make something so easily attributable to us. Why would Russia do this? They want to drive a wedge between the United States and Turkey. The Turks are lining up tanks on the border of Iraq to help, liberate Iraq from ISIS and drive towards the carving out of part of Iraq to align with a 1928 treaty, that may not be right, but somewhere in there, to actually have that become part of Turkey. So if Russia can drive a wedge between the Turks and the United States, that's our primary ally in the region, this can be a very effective strategy for Russia getting more influence over that area from Syria to Turkey. So we're seeing that they do this through a combination of marketing and misinformation, and it's not going unnoticed by some of the people in the media. If you look at the Ukraine MH17 downing, we had a Russian anchor resign from Russian state media because she was so appalled at the information that people were putting out there. This is very effective, though, and if you look at how the masses absorb information and through everybody being popular on social media and Twitter, people start to believe it. So let's talk about attribution. These guys are people, too. They come to work every day, and they carry out their job. So how can we attribute their attacks to that specific person? It's very difficult, but they all have motives and a typical way of working. And most of our data sources in the commercial sector do not give us that information. We're not intelligence agencies. We don't have, human SIGINT bolstering these analyst decisions. We're relying upon threat intel feeds of analyst conclusions based upon what they take apart from malware, and they put that in some repository. And we want to avoid basically the Norse Corp situation, okay, where all this data gets taken as gold and then it falls apart on its face when people start to look into it. We have to vet out that our data is accurate and reaching conclusions that, it's a certain actor because of, compile times or certain strings in a binary is just not going to be enough going forward. And it's not enough because our actors are evolving. The longer you fight the same adversary, the smarter they get, the more they learn about your decision-making process and your analyst workflows. And so when you look at how attackers are going to avoid attribution, they're going to start out by routing things through multiple geographies. They're going to change their infrastructure constantly. This infrastructure will be, by the time it gets to threat intel feeds, it's going to already be burned, most likely. It's just, you're talking about yesterday's infrastructure. They're going to have very good counterintelligence. They're going to know exactly how you think, what data sources you're using, what feeds they need to taint, and how they need to influence your cycle of decision-making, and just raise enough doubt in your mind that you can only reach moderate confidence in your conclusions. That you're not going to say, hey, it's a slam dunk. It's a slam dunk, there's WMDs, we're gonna go get them. It's not gonna be that easy. And lastly, anti-forensics, this is very important. So these guys have capabilities that they're not gonna wanna burn. They know when they put it out there, they're gonna get burned. So they're gonna try to avoid any forensics analysis by encrypting payloads and trying to evade core, prevent core capabilities from being compromised between each operation. It's very expensive to change your operating techniques every time. And then that disinformation component is so critical. When an analyst goes home at night and they're thinking about the problem set they saw, you're analyzing this malware, you're thinking about it while you're sleeping, what are some things that you need to see in the media to help you reach that conclusion? What are some things, how can we reinforce that as the adversary so that when you're watching CNN and you're watching your Twitter feeds, it all starts to reinforce what the doubts and the seeds of doubt that have already been planted. So the scenario, you work for the Russian government, GRU, let's say. You've been given the task to hack into the DNC and retrieve information to influence the US political election. I don't know if this story is familiar to anybody. But since we're planning to leak the information, we need someone to blame. We don't want this to come back on Mother Russia. So let's make sure that China gets blamed for this. And that's going to have some benefits for us, right? We could have sanctions put against China, which means that people are going to have to buy Russian oil instead of Chinese oil or other natural resources. So it's kind of a win-win situation for Russia if we can carry this out, because we actually get the benefit of putting whoever in office we want, and we can also influence the financial buying power of people that are purchasing from Chinese. So here's our ops flow. We're going to do some target recon. We're going to select an actor to mimic. So the target recon is going to tell us what the laydown looks like of the target, what the networks are, what kind of attack would be most fruitful. Then we're going to select an actor that's pretty proficient at carrying out that attack. And specifically, we're going to look for a very well-known one that analysts will be familiar with. We don't want this to be totally new. We want this to be very easy analytically for the people that are going to find this information. Then we're going to set up our infrastructure to mimic what that actor is. And then we're going to taint some feeds, and we're going to walk through this as we launch this attack. And then we're going to go through with hopefully some audience participation on what the conclusions might be. So as you might expect, this political party is a typical target environment of a small office. We've got, they rented some space out of some building. They've got a little Comcast router and a bunch of clients. And all these guys do is send emails, make phone calls, and open documents. So they're all about online collaboration. And it's typical Windows environments. They went and bought some HP laptops, and that's what they hand out to everybody. So the simplistic architecture does limit our attack surface. But because of that, we're going to choose phishing as a really, really good attack vector. Now we're going to choose a target to mimic. So some of the popular actors, I don't know who names these things, but good names, Iron Tiger and Deep Panda, very similar in the flavor of Chinese CNE, but we look at the characteristics of these actors. We've got callback servers that are located in China. Okay, they're not really trying to hide anything. The file names and passwords were in the actual malware and files that were captured were Chinese. The malware binaries were compiled with computers that had Chinese language sets and Chinese symbols. They used a very common Poison Ivy remote access tool. This is easily attainable online, and we can recompile it to evade any detection. And then domains were very, very pro, very Chinese, right? So we're going to choose something that looks similar to this. And then lastly, they sent emails from 163.com, which is a very common email provider. So when we go to mimic this infrastructure, we want to be as close to that profile in every previous analyst report that anybody's ever read for those two actors. We're gonna purchase a beige VPN account. We're gonna go make sure that we have infrastructure that matches the analyst reports to a T. We're gonna set up keyboards and build a computer that is exactly matching the character sets that we saw in these actors. We're gonna find either an expired domain that they use, because people just don't renew bad infrastructure, or we're going to register new domains through a cutout. Then we're gonna host a C2 server in China to line up with the previous tradecraft. And this server is going to be on a China VPS, something we can take up and down quickly. Alibaba Cloud is amazingly reliable these days. And then register emails on the right email provider. Okay, so basic stuff here, but now we're getting to the fun stuff. So as we build out new information, we want to make sure that this new infrastructure we set up is actually already in the feeds. So I want the analyst to reach the conclusion without a lot of hard work. I want them to see the attack and then immediately see that this is being carried out from various places on the globe. We're not the only attacker, or we're not the only recipient of this attack. Lots of data points need to line up here. So we're going to associate all the new infrastructure to that same actor. And then we're going to reinforce those associations. So if you're an intelligence agency, you can probably get enough people to actually reinforce this for you and add in the data to these open source feeds. But If you're a low-budget operation and you want to actually carry this out at scale, you need to build long-running profiles on all the threat intel feeds, and this is critical. We need to build. We don't want this to be a new profile with new upvotes and new intelligence coming in. It'll look too obvious. So we need to have some semblance of norm in our OSINT profiles. And so these guys are going to inherit accounts that we've been maintaining over the past few years. And these accounts will be given to unknowing, unwitting freelancers. So we're going to go on Mechanical Turk. We're going to go on Freelancer, any of the other ones that are out there. We're going to give them a specific set of tasks to do. And these tasks are going to be, hey, log into this account, go to this link, hit the up button. And there's ways to obfuscate that. But frankly, what we're going to look for is workers that have high reliability, that do a task regardless without asking questions. They're going to have probably some limited English language proficiency and very little network knowledge. So we're going to find people that are not going to ask a lot of questions. And then we're going to go take these attributes and just upload them into the systems. And we successfully carried this out, even though Mechanical Turk rules do prohibit you from asking them to log into things. People will do it if you raise the hit price up. Now, for the poison ivy rat, people are using VirusTotal to analyze this stuff. So we want that to also be prevalent. So we're gonna go ahead and take our hash and load it in there, and it'll get caught. At least it should. And then we're gonna make sure that there's comments. So let's go ahead and put some comments into VirusTotal saying, hey, I'm seeing this from this account, I'm seeing this from this account. Let's go ahead and bolster that information so it looks like that this attack is widespread. And it's really lining up, telling a more of an aggressive story about this is a broad campaign. This isn't very targeted. This is very, very much a broad Chinese campaign that went after lots of different people. Then we're going to conduct the attack. So this is the easiest part of this. Does that email look familiar? Yeah, so political organizations are all about collaboration. They're going to open emails. They're going to click on things. And we're going to wait for that victim to open it up. And then timing here is super, super important. We want to taint the feeds immediately before and after the attack is conducted, so that we want to get some data points before the email sent, some data points after. Their cycle for catching this will likely not be fast enough to prevent the attack anyway. But at least the data starts to line up. We get the callbacks. We take the data that we want. And then we start burning everything down. So let's leak the data. Let's get caught, and let's frame the mimic. Let's put the this is like Ocean's 13 over here. So we've already laid the groundwork for plausible deniability. If we're Russia, everything's in place. Nothing points back to us, from what we can tell. We're going to shift blame to China. So we're going to release some news stories. We're going to push some social media out talking about a rise in Chinese cyber attacks. We're going to get that retweeted. We're going to use Marketo to take a campaign out. We're going to hit a few threat intel source. Threat intel mailing lists. Maybe we even will get it into InfraGuard. We'll send it out through US CERT. We'll try to infiltrate these organizations and send out those indicators of compromise or indicators of attack. And then we're going to co-opt third parties. Hopefully we can get some folks in the community, maybe some in this room, to retweet something that looks real, that looks legitimate. So it starts to bolster the conclusions inside the community. And then we're going to burn all the infrastructure, so the investigation side just has limited data to work with. So this is the audience participation part. How many in the room think that Russia did it? No hands? Not one. One. Two. Okay. A few. There has to be a few skeptics, okay? How many people conclude that based on this information, if you were presented this, with these tradecraft characteristics and this infrastructure, would conclude it's China? Yeah, a lot more hands. So the point here is that we took this data and we passed it to some of our analysts internally who've done this in the past, and presented with this information, with all the backstopping that we put in place, they were really forced not to make another conclusion. They had to conclude that it was China. We left them no wiggle room, so to speak. And the only way that we could really get to the source of truth here was to keep digging. But if that infrastructure is already burned and all of the connectivity to those redirector boxes is gone, we're left with limited evidence. And our feeds, our data feeds for OSINT and threat intel, like all of it lines up. We have to do information sharing to trust and trust our community, but it does present us some problems. So the reality, attribution is very hard. I think everybody in this room realizes that. Without successful attribution, though, we cannot have successful deterrence. So the basis for our nuclear deterrence strategy that we've been pursuing for 50 years has been that we will see missiles coming from that country of origin, and we know when to fire our nukes back. In the cyber world, we don't know that yet. We can't attribute attacks without very good intelligence sources. And in the commercial world, we're very limited in what those data sources are. Misattribution can have very bad consequences. I'm not saying it could lead to World War III, but you know that case is certainly on the table. These disinformation campaigns do cast enough doubt for us to really have to take a hard look at what the existing threat intel workflow is and what the data sources are that we're using when we make these conclusions. I'm not saying the threat intel is useless. I mean, it is. I believe in crowdsourced information sharing, but we just need to be cognizant of the information that we're using to reach very conclusive decisions and use that to drive strategic outcomes. This process of basing political actions on some analyst conclusion, we've got to be very careful with that. So lastly, a plug for my company. We're recruiting hackers from all over the world to come in and find vulnerabilities in our clients' apps and infrastructure. And this is one of the most effective offensive solutions that we've been able to come up with. This hacker-powered security is hopefully changing the way that we do app and infrastructure security. Now I got to the Q&A section. We're going to follow this with beers and food at McClellan's. I'd like to open it up now.
If misattribution campaigns are as easy as you say, why haven't we seen them before now if we have? And if we have, can you describe one?
So the misattribution campaigns we've seen to date have been other actors. So we have seen in, what's a good example?
TB5 on APT28.
So when people start investigating the malware, they started to pass back from the C2 servers new binaries that started to have different characteristics. Okay, and those characteristics would be, different language sets. They tried to make it look like somebody else was carrying out the attack. So we are seeing some of this in active campaigns where they're trying to cover their tracks.
Is that nation state campaigns?
Or yes.
Then why are they screwing up so bad that you're able to detect it? It would seem like it should be easier to do a misinformation campaign.
I think that's a great. So the question is, why is it not easier to carry out a misinformation campaign, right? So I think the reality is it's very hard to do one that's quite good. But we need to be cognizant of it, and I think what you're seeing in some of the successful identification of misinformation campaigns is that the analysts bring a healthy sense of skepticism to the data.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so the question is if attributes of the malware, like Cyrillic keyboard sets, could be part of the misinformation, and yes, it could be, it absolutely could be, but we're hoping that our intelligence community has better data, and that in this current scenario, they're basing their conclusions on more than just that. Yes? It It could be either. That's the how do you tell what's part of the disinformation campaign? It could be at any point in the chain. At some point, you need to spot, is it part of the campaign or is it just sloppiness? So
It feels to me like one of the major challenges that we're facing is that it's not just it's not just commercial space, it's not just military space that's facing or that's having is pulling in this information and doing the analysis of it. I have been working with a number of open source teams and academic teams that have been doing analysis on international actors, sometimes with State Department funding. We've been doing this kind of analysis. Sometimes it's other countries, NGOs. And so I think one of the challenges there is that, there is so much, I'm not sure if there's enough intercommunication between all of the groups that are doing this. What do you think is sort of most important to share across commercial, military, government, NGOs, and academics? And what kinds of things, especially would you say that, academic groups need to do to up their game and make sure they're not passing along disinformation?
So I think what's missing in some of the analysis is the analyst notes. I think the analyst notes are probably the most important part, right? They need to talk about how they reach those conclusions, not just putting a report out saying, I reached this conclusion. So walk us through your data points and walk us through your rationale. At some point, threat intel is going to have to, in this attribution game, is it going to have to just go back to just core intelligence analysis, right? And I think that's somewhat lacking in some of the folks we're putting out there in the field. They need to go back and just look at how intelligence analysis is done. Take a healthy skepticism in some of the data.
Yeah, how's it going? So considering hacking in itself is rooted in deception, this is a real URL, this is a real email, the boogeyman of misidentifying something or misattributing something is a consistent normal into our daily lives and everything we look at. So it's something that in most cases I see is expected, that somebody's deceiving me somewhere. And I think that's the root of good and bad analysis or good and bad attribution. I noticed in the example you provided, and I came in a little late, that it was very indicator-centric. How do you consider leveraging social, geopolitical, facts and details and evidence which surround the entire use case around how the indicators play out, who they targeted at the time it was targeted, what they did, actions on the objective, what effect is being delivered. When you consider the technical and non-technical, how does that then shape your attribution picture?
Right. So when you take that into account, you have to look at what are the political motivations. It's a great point. Because the actors aren't doing this just for fun most of the time. They either want money if they're a criminal gang, or from a government perspective, they have some political goal. And I think that has to be part of the conversation. Why would somebody do this? It'll drive us towards the right conclusion, because if the Chinese had no motivation to carry out this type of attack, it wouldn't make sense, and we'd go back and question that data. So it does have to line up into a broader picture. And I think that requires lots of reading on the part of our analysts to understand the geopolitical climate. I think the Turkey thing is really interesting. Turkey driving a wedge between Turkey and the United States is so current, but people have to see through that and say, well, why would the U.S. hack a Turkish energy grid? That doesn't make sense. So.
Right now, we're seeing two different targets for the attribution information. One are professionals and decision makers who understand at least a certain level of what you're talking about today, and the other is the general public. One of the concerns that I see is when the attribution information comes out with the here's our conclusions and we're experts, trust us. What we've seen in the past 3 weeks has been first the FBI DHS jar with no information whatsoever other than here's our conclusion, followed up by what was supposed to be the here's the real story from DNI, which again said, trust us, published by somebody who had been proven publicly to have lied publicly on the subject. So this leads to the question, how can companies like Senate, CrowdStrike, and others establish a level of trustworthiness with the general public?
Look, definitely a valid point. So. Again, I'm going to go back to just supplying more information about how they reach their conclusions. They need to just tell it straight and say, this is what we know, this is why we think this, and this is the confidence that we're applying to it. The intelligence community is never going to tell us, right, how they reach their conclusion, because they're going to have to protect their sources and methods. But in the commercial world, we ought to be able to share that. We ought to be able to say that this is why I think that, and this is all the data I have. And if you want to reach a different conclusion out of it, you're free to do that. But at the end of the day, you know, I think most commercial companies are actually more focused on the malware side of it and stopping the attacks. And they don't really need to concern themselves most of the time with who's doing it, unless they're a much larger organization. You know, the government aspect of it, when we start to talk about our retaliatory strikes or anything like that, we definitely need firm attribution.
So sort of along those same lines, I think one question is when to go public. Like, should there be moments where people don't go public with their findings just yet? Or what kinds of, you know, vetting should be done before things go out to the... Because we have, you know, groups like WikiLeaks, for example, that will start making claims early on.
I think we need to ask ourselves, you know, the motivation for WikiLeaks to actually do this, right? That's part of the question. I think going public with findings early is better, and sharing that in a consistent way with folks is good. Information sharing, I think, should be promoted, but we have to make sure that we're vetting out the people that are joining those information sharing networks, and I think the vetting to get into some of these is just too light right now.
So, did Russia do it?
I'm going to agree with the IC on this one. Yes, I think Russia did it.
Right after this talk, there's another talk in, I think it's Belay, by the director of research from Threat Connect that I think you'll all find very interesting.
Yep. Agreed. They're doing some really cool stuff. Okay, well, join us afterward for more anti-attribution talks, and thank you for attending.